Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. Today I'm going to introduce you the library RAPIDS to do machine learning and feature engineering in your GPU for many of the algorithms in machine learning that you probably are working with. What is RAPIDS? RAPIDS is more than a library, it's a collection of libraries. It's a framework which allows you to use the scikit-learn, GIS libraries, graph libraries like NetworkX in your GPU. Essentially, it's not a wrapper of the libraries. They rewrite the libraries to be used in the GPU. You probably know, for those that are machine learning or deep learning practitioners, that there was a lot of efforts to how to say speed up the processing of deep learning libraries like TensorFlow or Keras or PyTorch. There was many people working on improving these libraries, these deep learning libraries, and this also ends up in transformers and improving as well the training and the speeding up. And there is still a lot of people working on this area, how to improve, especially with the arrive of the LLMs, how to speed up the training and inference and hyperparameter tuning of LLMs and deep learning libraries in GPUs. But with the conventional machine learning algorithms and other areas were completely forgotten, like those algorithms like we have in scikit-learn or in libraries to other libraries like DBSCAN for clustering or many others, no? At the end, libraries as well like GeoPandas to work with GIS information, or like NetworkX to work with graph databases or graphs in general, no? So those libraries that we still are using in many places, they didn't have access to the GPU, and we had to train in many cases a lot of information, use a lot of information and spend days or at least many hours and resources of our time, because this not only the libraries itself, also the data, pandas in this case, many of these algorithms was with pandas or NumPy, they were not suitable, or they were not be ready to work in a GPU. As you probably know, to work in the GPU, you need to move not only the model that you are training, you have to move as well the data. And then on again, there is a lot of research, a lot of effort done in doing this for deep learning algorithms, but nobody was working for algorithms like random forest or KNN or K-means or many others that you probably need to use, or you need to use dimensionality reduction. Again, many models that you are working on your daily business, time series forecasting as well, many of these things, ARIMA, all these algorithms that you use for other purposes. Not everything is in machine learning or in AI. Not everything is LLMs and deep learnings. There is many other areas that they are losing attention, if you want to say that, and nobody were investing time and effort in improving and speeding up these algorithms, which also many times demands or need a lot of data to be trained, or essentially your problem is you have a lot of data in your project, and then those algorithms before they were not ready to not to work, they were working in CPUs, but they were not, they didn't have access to a GPU. And then that's exactly what RAPIDS is doing for us. RAPIDS, as I said, is working in a is allow us to access and to use these algorithms. I will cover some of them. There is many things that you can do with RAPIDS. As I said, it's a framework, a collection of libraries which allow you to work with conventional machine learning algorithms in your GPU. And to do, they had two main libraries. One is QDF, which allow us to work pandas flavor in the GPU. So we move the data to our GPU and we do the transformations in the GPU using QDF, and also equivalent or rewrited versions of most of the scikit-learn algorithms and many other areas. We can cover this. You can go. I will post you later on the documentation. I will later as well upload, as usual, all these notebooks I will show you now to the repository. And you can see here, I will give you the links to the documentation, but you can also go to RAPIDS AI and you can take a look to the documentation. It's quite extensive. They do a lot of things. You will be impressed, believe me. So they can go with, first of all, QDF. They can also do ETL processes in ETL with QDF, no? Essentially working at rewriting the pandas library to work in the GPU. QML, CUML is this is an abbreviature of CUDA machine learning, and then is rewriting the main algorithms like random forest, KNN, K-means. All these algorithms that you have or we have in scikit-learn are had a version. Most of them have a version in lasso regression, random forest regressor, while logistic regression. Those algorithms that we all of us know and they are still in use for many poor problems is more suitable to use those algorithms which cover very specific use cases rather than to use deep learning, because in many cases we need to prepare complex loss functions in PyTorch or in TensorFlow, which complicate a lot. And don't forget as well that to prepare the data for for a neural network is much more complicated than today for most of these algorithms, scikit-learns. And then on again, we can work in the GPU. We have as well QGraph to work with the graph analytics, with the graph data, the objects, mainly working together with NetworkX, the famous library before Neo4j and other competitors that Neo4j had. NetworkX was the only one library which allow us to work with graphs. Also, we have a spatial. This is to work with GIS information, GeoPandas or other libraries, but mainly focus they create a version of GeoPandas and many others. Also a version for Spark and RAF. Well, take a look, computer vision. They had some stuff as well in computer vision. Well, and also visualization is quite important as well. They integrated with some of the most common visualization frameworks. And then, as you probably know, this is quite extensive, quite demanding activity that you probably you face this problem. For example, how to visualize millions of data points in a plot, in a correlation plot. This is taking hours, taking days. It's with this they move the process into the GPU, and it's obviously faster than doing on the GPU. The in how faster? Well, every problem or every library is optimized for some of the most common algorithms in the area, and then, as I say in many occasions and in previous videos where I also spoke about optimization with other libraries like Namba, like NumPy, Vectorize, like the just-in-time compiler or others, or fun tools or others that we saw in previous videos, you need to try and you need to check which one suit the best to your specific problem. But again, these guys have made something that speed up libraries that were a little bit cornered. You know, nobody was looking at them, because today, well, it's generative AI, deep learning, everything had to be solved with that. And believe me, in many cases, there is here solutions that are mature, tested for years, for decades in some cases, like these forecasting libraries, like or algorithms like Arima or Sarima or others, which are tested for decades, and we know very well that they work. And many of the algorithms that are available in scikit-learn are also broadly tested and by the scientist community. So having a version of logistic regression, for example, that can work in a GPU and approach problems that before were not possible because of the time that you need to process data and train or fit a model into a CPU. This gives us a lot of the tools, a lot of chances to work with algorithms that we perfectly know and we know that they work and they are tested for millions of scientists and machine learning practitioners all over the world. So we go to the topic. We are going to start with QDF. I will give you just a quickly, let me show you one of the, where is this? Well, I lose it, but it doesn't matter. QGraph, maybe it's, no, it probably is here. Okay. QDF guide users. Yeah, probably is here. API reference. Well, I wanted just to show you with this, essentially the main two libraries, or under my perspective, especially for ML practitioners, are QDF and QML. And they both are designed to replace, first of all, QDF to replace Pandas. It's a new library. They rewrite the library, but with rewriting in such way that they can work. So once you move the data to the GPU, all the transformations happens on the GPU. And similarly with all these algorithms like Random Forest or Nearest Neighbor, I will show you two examples. All these transformations, you move the model and you do the transformations of the data into the GPU. So we start with the QDF. The QDF is the version, the wrapped version of Pandas. It's not fully implemented the API of Pandas. There is some missing, especially on the strings area, because they didn't transform or refactor all the strings methods that are available in Pandas, but it practically is 95% or more of the Pandas API available as a set in the GPU. So we replicate one of the examples that we had in that I use In the previous videos with other tools, with Numba, with the Fun Tools and Vectorize, and then we do here exactly the same. We are going to compare QDF with the conventional pandas method apply, with the just-in-time compiler of Numba, and with NumPy Vectorize. So we create a data frame with 1 million of rows, only 2 columns with integers in between 1 to 200. And we just create a simple function which sum up the values of the 2 columns. And then here we have different versions of the of Numba just-in-time compiler. Here is just the simple one. This is compiling the function in machine code, and then once it's compiled, the data go to, well, it's a this is this function, this version of the function is close to the GPU, and everything happens very close. You don't need to do the transfer of the from memory to the GPU, because this version of the function is already there. And then there is some parameters like parallel, cache, and parallel. Well, you can take a look to the video I did some days before, and it's on the channel. I spoke about Numba and compare it with the mainly with the NumPy vectorize and with the conventional apply of pandas data frame. So here we just apply the function. We had to do is with lambda row, because we had more than one column. We cannot apply the function directly to the series, to the pandas series. Probably you know that here applying lambda row is quite inefficient, because we had to read the whole row and load it in memory, and then unselect the 2 ones that we are interested with. This sometimes happens here on the function, but some other times happens inside the function itself. The function. Sorry. Sometimes occurs in the function itself, and then it's quite inefficient. Here in any case it's not very relevant, because we only had 2 columns, but in other cases when we had thousands of columns, this is quite important, because again you had to load the data in memory, and this method is quite inefficient. It's not the worst, because the worst probably is iter rows or iter tuples, but is also, well, quite inefficient in comparison with other. It took 17.7 seconds to do the application using just in time compiler, different flavors. We had 6.35, blah blah blah. So the best one is using cache and parallel. This is using multiple threads of the GPU to do the calculations with the parallel argument. So yeah, it's quite fast. Probably for some problems you need to, yeah, the best option in some problems is just in time compiler, because you are transforming the function into machine code, and it is the transformation is fast. There is nothing better than doing this. You compile the function, you create the machine code, code base, and you make cache and parallelization, and this is this is a lightning. It's really really fast. Nothing can be, but as I show you in these videos I upload about Numba, it doesn't apply or it doesn't switch for many. For some problems, for some complex functions, the complexity to transform the function into machine code is not worthy, or is even worse, is performing even worse than just simply applying the conventional apply method of pandas. You can watch the video, it's on the channel. You can see there all these details. Here we apply vectorize, which is better than the pandas apply, but in comparison with the just-in-time compiler for this specific function is worse. And we apply here the, we use QDF, no? QDF, we need to create the data frame. Once we create the data frame, we just simply, let's check it out here. Well, it doesn't really matter. You will understand now what I'm going to explain you. It's probably better to do it because we're here as well. The data frame is outside of the calculations here. We will not put it as well on the calculations. So here, what we do with the Q data frame, here we create the data frame and we move it to the GPU, and then on we apply the formula. This apply is happening on the GPU. And then on the time is not better than the just-in-time compiler, but it's really fast in comparison even with vectorized. This is kind of vectorization as well, but happening on your GPU. Again, this is this specific algorithm. Here we are not considering the time that you need to move the data frame to the GPU, because you need to consider this as well. But in any case, you see, it's quite faster in comparison with the conventional pandas apply. So, as I mentioned you, not all the string methods or functions are translated to QDF. Here you have the list of them. Every version, I suppose, they will be including the rest, but you can, you at least you can use those one, no? And here you have an example. This function, a similar one, I use it on the previous videos where I was working with Numba, with the just-in-time compiler, with the vectorize, with the FunTools. FunTools are cache, have cache methods to cache the data close to the CPU, and this way you don't need to move it. It's using different approaches, like the most recent, the less recent data that you saw, etc. There is different approaches. You can take a look as well to the videos you have on the channel. And here, in this specific type of problems, the algorithms, those algorithms perform really badly, even worse, but even by far, in comparison with the Panda series, with the apply method, no? And why? Because, well, to transform this code, in, for example, with the just-in-time compiler, is very, very complex, no? And then it takes a lot of time, and you are losing a lot of time because this is compilation on the fly. When the code get this point, and you had here the decorator, at that moment happens, you had the compilation, and this function is not happening again, and you don't activate the cache, for example. What happened is that it takes a lot of time to compile it, to compile the function, and you don't use it anymore, and it takes a lot of time to compile because it's very complex, and these functions with a lot of ifs, nested ifs, and many controls, no, to check if the strings are have, for example, here, if there is some length, checking if the first or the N word or the N letter. These kind of things, to translate it into machine code, is very expensive in terms of time, and then on the time that you get compiling the information, you lose it if you just need to, you just use it one time, no? And then you will see here that similarly this happens with QDF, because you need to move the data to the GPU, and then on the transformation, this transformation is happening in the GPU. And then you will see here that for this specific example, this is the best option using QDF. Because This function takes approximately 132 seconds in between creating the series and applying the transformation, and doing the same with QDF is taking 3 times less. No? So if you compare with the previous methods that I use, maybe we can use, maybe this can happen here. Just let me show you. We just apply. So let's check it. No, it's that one. One second. Here we are. You can see here the function is taking 527 milliseconds using the JIT compiler, the just-in-time compiler. This why, as I said, to transform some complex functions when even not correctly design, no? This is very complex to be transformed to machine to code machine code, code that is close to what that the CPU understand, and if you spend a lot of time to transform this and all the calculations even that is done, let's imagine that you need to calculate this with the minimal function, no, with the simple functions, that is what the CPU understands, and then only is probably is gonna be a very long number of functions, and then on applying this to the data is taking much more time than doing the same transformation in your GPU. Here we need to move the data to the GPU, but even though the time is faster. So as I said in all these videos I upload about performance, you need to try, you need to check all what you know, and apply the method that best suit to your problem. I think even I show you in some of the cases that only refactoring the code, you are improving the speed of the execution, because many times we don't take care we don't do a correct analysis of what we had to expect, or even that we can use some other available blocks or programming blocks available in Python that make or perform better than a simple if case, if elif. This is quite inefficient, you probably know, because it start enter here and many cases are going to enter. It's going to check everything, and it's very inefficient this stuff. Okay, but again, take a look to make your own tests. If you want, take a look to the other tests that we made. They are available on the channel, and you will see that. Now we have a number of the tools that they will help us to speed up our code, the transformations is our code, and QDF is one of the tools that we had. It's performing very fast in some scenarios, and it can help you to solve if you have a bottleneck in your application, is something that really can help in some scenarios. Okay, let's move now to the QML. QML is the library which essentially is rewriting most of the let me find it out. QDF. Well, here is what I wanted to show you about the QDF pandas. you see how what is the workflow, and case that the operation is supported, you have to move it to the GPU. But in some cases, this operation is not. So there is a penalty on this workflow, and if sometimes this penalty, this penalization will be worth it, some other cases will be not. QML, we had, let me show you, most of the home, let me show you here, model configuration. So we had here, as you can see on the left, you had pre-processing metrics, regression, classification, clustering, dimensionality reduction, manifold learning, neighborhoods, time series, model explainability. So you had here SAF, for example, you had ARIMA, SARIMA, Hall, Winters, algorithms. So those algorithms were practically cornered, nobody took care. These days about this, but there is still many places where we need to use them. Clustering, like K-means, DBSCAN, and many others. Regression and classification, you have here probably, I don't know if they are all, but it's many of them. Random forest, quasi Newton, nearest neighbors, support vector machine. Yeah. And again, many times we are focusing only in solving everything with deep learning, and many times one of these algorithms performs very well for some simple algorithms. The only problem is that you have a lot of data and you cannot afford to spend days in training or fitting one of these algorithms. And here, well, QML help you to do this. We are going to review one example. It's a random forest classifier. It's essentially a binary classifier. Here we use we create a data frames with the make classification. This is a method from scikit-learn to create a mock data. We have a data frame with 16,384 rows, 399 columns, which is what is to do a random forest classifier. Yeah, it's gonna take a lot of time. With this data frame, to be honest, not a lot. 14 seconds. If you increase the number of the of rows here, you have the chance here to grow up to. I try with to the 17, and finally I say no way. This is. After 1 hour, I stopped the training because it took a lot of time. Then I wanted to show you something, and then I reduced the number of examples. So here we just create a data frame. This is conventional pandas, train test split, 20% for texting. And now we create the same, we reuse, or sea, we take the pandas data frame and we convert it in QDF data frames, we move them to memory, and we do the fitting. You have here fitting in scikit-learn, evaluation scikit-learn, fitting in QML, and evaluation in QML. So the training is 7 times faster with this small data set, and the evaluation 293 times faster. And you can see it's exactly the same methods, the same API that you are using for scikit-learn is using in QDF. You don't need to change anything. You just import the correct class from QML and you have it. To refactor your old code to the new code is very, very easy. Here we have another example with nearest neighbors. Here we had we create another data frame with make blocks, another tool from scikit-learn. We fit a model with scikit-learn, only 5 centers. And here, where is, let me check. Scikit-learn, QML, Q nearest neighbors. Exactly. Five centers. We use key scale nearest neighbors and the version that we had available in QML. And you have here the output, 201 milliseconds in comparison with 121, practically half of the time. And here, doing inference here, it took 30.7 seconds, and in QML 32.8. Well, probably here again is performing better, but it's not such fantastic output that we will expect. Try with other examples. You can try with other, as I said, with other algorithms. This is a little bit, in this case, a little bit disappointed. But okay, you can take a look to the other algorithms and see how it. In the previous one was much better. In this case, well, it didn't work very well. Okay, and the last thing I want to show you, there are two additional interfaces. One is QSpatial. This is to work with GIS data, Geographical Information System. And you can see, for those that work before with GeoPandas, it will allow us to work with this kind of objects, polygons, the points, multi-polygons, and do pandas, GeoPandas is prepared for that. It's had not only the same interface that pandas, it's also extending this with a lot of methods which allow you to change or to convert coordinates, or to also calculate, for example, the area of a polygon, how much area one polygon are inside another polygon. For people who is working with GIS data, this is a fantastic tool. There is many others also for visualization that are specialized in GIS. And what the Rapids did is to create a version of GeoPandas that works in GPU. They just simply rewrite the tool, and they had the QSpatial Geo series, and they are exactly the same methods that you have in GeoPandas, but translated to those that works in the GPU, and exactly the same. So again, for those that are working with this data, they will be very, very thankful for that. And the same for people who work with graphs, for those that probably most of you know today, Neo4j. I upload several videos of the working with the data science library, the GDS library. They are on the channel. And then when you are working with the graph data, they are also very heavy, very demands a lot of the processing, especially just imagine that some of the biggest graphs in the world are in Facebook or in these social networks. They use graph algorithms intensively to find community, to find the community of the nodes, the distance, many, many things that are today on the graph theory, with a lot of the possible algorithms to use, and many of them demands as well a lot of processing, especially when the graph is complex. There is a lot of relations in between nodes, multiple nodes types, and many interrelated. When you have to do search or apply algorithms to again calculate similarity, calculate link prediction, or embeddings, even whatever you need to do with graphs, start to be very intensively demanding, no? Processing demanding, even more than the equivalent. When there is not really equivalence in between this and graph machine learning or graph data science with the conventional machine learning. And well, again, having access to the GPU is really appreciated. So they are doing an interface with Network X. It's a well-known library to work with nodes and relationships in between them. And again, take a look these notebooks. You see, they can work in a conventional GPU, in a domestic. This is a B100. If you want to work in a, we can run this in a Google Colab notebook. And yeah, I will pass this over to you, and you can take a look and also to the documentation. There is plenty of examples for every algorithm you had available on the libraries, on the framework. You can take a look if something suits correctly to the problem you had. Try it, and well, maybe you had a problem before with a bottleneck in some calculations. You can solve it with RAPIDS. And again, you had others. I already showed you on the channel many of them, some of them, to work with GPUs, to work with compiling the code, to use some other techniques like vectorization or caching or using caches, these kind of things, which at the end is performing the execution of the code. Python, you probably know, it's not the best, it's not the fastest language in the world. It's probably one of the slower today. No, years ago was one of the best. Today, well, had a lot of functionality, but probably it's going to be very difficult to replace Python for all the machine learning stuff that we are doing. But yeah, knowing these tools is going to be always very helpful for you, and well, you know, now you already know that they are there, and just take a look and compare. As I say, always test it, try the different options you have, and choose the best. Okay, that's all. Thank you very much for watching this video, and I will upload the content after I finish. And as I say, usually give me a like if you like the video, you find it interesting. Subscribe to the channel if you didn't do it before, and share with your colleagues and friends to promote the content of my channel. Thank you very much. Bye bye.